Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this, the fifth meeting in 2016 of the Economy, Energy and Tourism Committee. Can I welcome members? Can I welcome our witnesses, who we'll come to in a moment, and welcome visitors in the gallery? And can I remind everyone, please, to turn off or at least turn to silent all mobile phones and other electronic devices so they don't interfere with the committee's work. We have apologies this morning from the Deputy Convener, Dennis Robertson. We also have apologies from Patrick Harvey, who has to be at the Rural Affairs Committee, but hopes to join us shortly. Item one on the agenda, can I ask if members are content that we consider our session four legacy paper in private at future meetings?
Agreed.
That's agreed, thank you. Item two, we are taking evidence on the issue of employee-owned businesses and cooperatives. I'd like to thank our witnesses for attending. We earlier this morning, we had an informal session presented by Sarah Deas from Co-operative Development Scotland. Thank you for that, Sarah. Setting out some background to the session we're now having. The history to this is it follows on from some work the committee did in our inquiry into work, wages and well-being, where we published a report a few weeks ago. And as we did that work, we received quite a lot of evidence suggesting that models where there was a higher level of employee participation in the business were good for productivity, they were good for the broader success of the business as well, clearly as improving the employee experience. And that was an area we felt probably deserved a bit more scrutiny. So we had a session last week, a roundtable session last week, on the question of social enterprises, which I think was quite a success. And this morning we're looking at the question of cooperatives and employee-owned businesses, which I would stress are not the same thing, although there are clearly parallels. So I think before we get into the discussion, I think it'd be helpful if we just went around the table and we all introduced ourselves. And if you're here as a witness, if you just say who you are and where you're from, and perhaps just a little bit about the organisation that you represent, that would be helpful in terms of setting the scene. So my name is Murdo Fraser. I am the convener of the committee, and I'm an MSP for Mid Scotland and Fife. Hand over to Chick.
Chick Brody, MSP for South of Scotland, and a member of the EET committee.
Simon Fowler, I'm the Partnership Registrar for John Lewis, which is an unusual title. I'm an independent role on the John Lewis board, which is bringing democratic vitality to John Lewis, given its ownership structure, and humanity to commerce. I'm also here as chair of the Employee Ownership Association.
Gordon MacDonald, MSP for Edinburgh Pendleton.
Nick Kuenssberg, chairman of Scott and Fife, which is an employee-owned company, and also an ambassador for Co-operative Development Scotland. But I also wear a hat as chairman of Social Investment Scotland, so I'm involved in the social enterprise debate as well.
Richard Lyle, MSP Central Region.
Karen Pickering, Page Park Architects. We're an employee-owned business. We've been employee-owned business for 2 years, and we have 52 employees.
Lewis MacDonald, MSP, representing North East Scotland.
I'm Andrew Pendleton. I'm an academic based at the University of Durham. I've been doing research on employee ownership and employee share ownership for perhaps rather longer than I care to remember. I'm currently doing a major survey of employee-owned firms in the UK.
Sarah Deas, I lead Co-operative Development Scotland, which is the arm of Scottish Enterprise, working in partnership with Highlands and Islands Enterprise that promotes business growth through cooperative and employee ownership models.
Joanna Lamont, MSP for Glasgow Pollock.
Calum Currie, Chairman of Portpatrick Harbour Community Benefit Society, a small community down the west coast of Scotland. We've just purchased a harbour.
Kelly McIntyre, I'm Programme Manager for Community Share Scotland. We are a support and advice service that has been funded for a three-year period by Big Lottery and Carnegie to provide support and advice to community groups and organisations to help them through the process of setting up community benefit societies, as well as looking to the community shares model mechanism for funding projects and enterprises they may be taking on a community level, be that of place or interest.
Joan McAlpine, MSP for the South of Scotland and member of the committee.
I'm Nathalie Agnew. I'm the Managing Director of Muckle Media, a PR agency, and also the Director of the WE agency, which is a cooperative that we've set up between a PR agency, a design agency and a website development company.
Joanna Dewar-Gibb, Director and Founding Member of Screen Facilities Scotland and Business Manager of RTM Limited, a physical special effects company. Screen Facilities Scotland is one of the consortium cooperative models here this morning, championing the growth and aspiration of the facilities and service companies in the film and television production sector in Scotland. We currently have 25 members and we're growing, and our members are vital to Scotland's production infrastructure, and our member companies range from those who are sole operators to those with 100-plus staff, servicing the practical and logistical needs of film, television and commercial production, as well as those of games industry, museums and live events.
Thank you very much. As a matter of interest, the committee did an inquiry last year into the creative industries, and we're doing a follow-up session on that next week, so that might be of interest.
That and SFS has submitted written evidence and will submit for next week's meeting as well.
Okay, thank you. And then we have the official report, who are there to note everything you say, and our team of clerks to assist. So we're going to run this probably till about 12 noon, I think. It'd be helpful if people making points could do that as succinctly as possible, because obviously there's quite a number of you around the table. I will chair the session. If you want to contribute, if you just catch my eye, I will bring you in as best I can. It would be helpful if somebody raises a point or asks a question and you have a particularly strong view, we want to hear from you. Particularly, we want to hear from you if you particularly agree with something that's been said, or even more so if you particularly disagree with something that's been said. So just catch my eye and I'll bring you in. You don't need, incidentally, to touch any of the equipment. It will all be operated remotely. I wonder if I could maybe just start off, and maybe I could direct this to some of the witnesses who are here from organisations that have been set up on an employee ownership or cooperative model. Just maybe just give us a flavour of why you felt that model was the right way to go, as opposed to perhaps a more traditional business model, and what you feel the benefits of that have been.
We were informally working together. There's three members of the WE agency, as I mentioned earlier: a PR agency, a design agency, and a web development company. And we're all very complementary to each other. So we were working on a number of projects informally together, but we faced a number of issues, things like contracts. You know, who's ultimately responsible for making sure that we deliver something for the end client? Where does the buck stop? Who's the point of contact? Who's looking after the admin? It was quite fortunate, really, that we got to test our relationship by working together informally. And then we found out about Co-operative Development Scotland and approached them really just to explore the options of us setting up a fourth entity, which we would each be members of. And it really made a lot of sense to us. It's helped us from a business development point of view. So we'll all go out and meet people and be pitching different elements of a business that aren't necessarily our own, looking at the kind of bigger goal of helping others to grow. But it's all very much based on commercially making money as individual businesses and collectively as the WE agency.
How important to you in terms of setting up was the advice you got from CDS?
Yeah, it was really super. I mean, we were provided with one-to-one support. We had a strategy session where we all sat together and you know, explored the different options that were open to us and agreed whether that was the right approach to take. And then we had completely free legal support that let us set up our cooperative, make sure everything was watertight. We had a lot of support with coming up with a members agreement. So again, who's responsible for what? What are we all committing to? We've actually had an interesting time where one of the members was bought out by a bigger company, and we had different options at that stage because of the strength of the members agreement around, you know, do we want to work with a new company? Do we want to vote them out and bring somebody else in? It's all gone really well, and it's been a positive experience. But I think we've had a lot more structure in place than we probably would have actually gone and got ourselves if we'd just been doing it on our own. So lots of direction, and particularly at a sort of strategic level of where do we want to get to and what do we need to consider.
Good. All right. Thank you for that. Okay, who else would like to contribute? Yeah, Simon.
The John Lewis Partnership has been going sort of in its retail form since 1864. So our founding sort of member was John Lewis Senior, who started a shop on Oxford Street in pretty much the same place as we trade at the moment in London. And he had two sons. One trained as a barrister, the other one stayed in the business. And the story goes that John Speeden Lewis, who was the founder of the John Lewis Partnership employee-owned model that we have today, fell off his horse in Regent's Park, spent 2 years recuperating from a punctured lung. And it was in that sort of period of time that he reflected on how unfair it was that the family, his brother, his father and himself, took home more than the employees that worked for them at the time in the shop in Oxford Street. They were silk merchants. They were the one of the most successful silk merchants on Oxford Street. And so he came up with this model, which wasn't pure altruism. It was about trying to develop a business which commercially was more successful than his competitors. And in order to do that, one of the things he felt was a key enabler was to try and ensure that employees, partners as they were eventually to be called in our business, had a stake in the business, and therefore felt both emotionally and financially engaged and committed to trying to make the business a real success. So he had lots of arguments with his father to try and get this idea across to him, because his father just did not agree with it. So Edwardian England, this wasn't the sort of thing, done thing. Eventually, he managed to strong-arm some money out of his father and walk down the King's Road, so the story goes, and bought Peter Jones, which is on Sloane Square. It was a Welsh hatter's shop at the time that wasn't doing very well. It was put up for sale. So he bought it, and his father allowed him to run a different sort of model in that shop whilst he worked in the main shop in Oxford Street. So he said, you can go and do your mad ideas in that bucket of a shop in Chelsea, as he called it, but you have to do a full day's work here in the family business. So he set up effectively the early part of the John Lewis Partnership as an employee-owned business way back then. He said to his employees that he had in Peter Jones that if you make a profit, then I will share the profit with you. That was his sort of first motivating position to them. 5 years later, he was making a profit. He introduced profit sharing, which is in existence today. So the first or second week of March, depending on when we announce our profits, is a very, very exciting moment for the 90,000 partners that work in the John Lewis Partnership. Nobody knows what the bonus figure is going to be, apart from the partnership board. And it's announced by distributing brown envelopes that have a little disc inside them, which have the percentage number on, because everyone receives the same percentage of their pay, which was deemed by the founder to be the fairest way of acknowledging someone's contribution to the business. And we choose different partners on bonus day to open that envelope and to bring to life, if you like, part of what the employee ownership meant for us. And it was then 10 years later that he put into place the first trust, because we're a trust-owned, employee-owned business, in 1929. And then it took right the way through till 1950, with Speeden working in the business, developing his ideas through the constitution of the John Lewis Partnership, which has got seven principles in it. He wanted to leave a legacy where no one forgot why he set the business up and how he set it up. So our first principle, which is often quoted within John Lewis, is really quite important in our business life, which is the partnership's ultimate purpose is the happiness of all its members through their worthwhile and satisfying employment in a successful business. Because the partnership is owned in trust for its members, they share the responsibilities of ownership as well as its rewards of profit, knowledge and power. And so, you know, effectively from 1929, Speeden then grew the business. He acquired a whole bunch of Selfridge provincial shops just before and just after the Second World War, when Selfridges weren't doing that well. He acquired a grocer, which was owned by a Mr. Waiter, Mr. Rose and a Mr. Taylor, that when it was brought into the business, Mr. Taylor left and Mr. Waiter, Mr. Rose continued running the business and it turned into Waitrose. You have seven shops in Scotland. We developed all sorts of things, our formal democracy, our knowledge sharing through a weekly publication called The Gazette, and lots of benefits that flow from being a co-owned business.
Thank you. Carol.
Inspired by the John Lewis model, so it was about 4 years ago that our partners decided that they would go down the employee-owned business route. So our initial kind of partnership structure was four partners who had a very kind of traditional business model in our architect's practice. It was set up 35 years ago, but what the partners decided was they were looking for a succession plan, but they wanted a succession plan that would keep the culture of the business, because we're a very kind of creative business. And so we took 2 years to actually get the employee-owned business set up. So we went through quite a lot of discussions. Co-operative Scotland, Development Scotland helped us with that, which was great. And we really included quite a lot of our employees in that process. So we realised that it was the right way for us to go. What we found, I mean, we've only been an employee in business for 2 years, but we found that it really has improved the kind of ethos of the practice. The culture hasn't changed, but the way that we all work now, it's a very much a holistic model where we all contribute to decisions. It's we have a board of trustees, so the shares cannot be sold. But what we have is a very kind of level structure. So all our, you know, now junior architects, they're on our finance committee, they're on different operations committees. So we all contribute to the direction of the business. I mean, we're architects, so we're not actually business people. So it's quite difficult for us when we first started out on this journey to actually understand how to run a business. I think the four partners just kind of did it by instinct. But what we've found over the past 2 years is we've learned more about business. And we've actually grown. When we first started out on this route, there was 35 of us. There's now 52 of us. And we found that our younger architects are wanting to stay with our practice and not kind of jump ship and go to different architects' firms, because they can see a future in the business, that it's a business that is going to continue. It's not going to be bought over by a big multinational company. We're very much a Scottish business as well. So I think that we're able to retain our staff and retain our talent because of that. And also within our business model now, we're able to innovate and investigate different avenues of architecture, which we probably wouldn't have done in the traditional partnership. We've got a graphics team that decided to kind of investigate more of the graphic side of our design company, and also an interiors team, which we didn't have previously. So there's opportunity for people within the business to say, oh, can I experiment in this direction? Also, like the John Lewis model, we have profit share, which is great. We kind of do that thing at the end of the year, because our financial year is actually the end of November. So we give our bonuses at Christmas time, which is an extra kind of incentive for staff. And what we do, we don't actually give a percentage. We give maybe 2 weeks' wages, or depending on the year. And obviously, we've only been running for 2 years, so that could change each year. But it really is based on the profits that we've made. We also keep a little bit of that profit share for charitable works as well. We've got quite a number of our architects who've got interest in helping communities abroad. So we send our architects out, and they help build housing for in kind of communities that need that, or soup kitchens in Africa. So there's a whole range of charitable ventures that we support as well. But I just think, from a personal point of view, when you know that you own part of the business, you work so much harder. I mean, when partners were owning the business, we just worked for them, which was fine. They were great partners. But to work for yourself really does incentivize you. And even things like, oh, should I print out these drawings? Or maybe I shouldn't print them because I'm paying for these prints. So it's little things like that which really kind of help in your day-to-day running of how you work. And also our clients. I think our clients, when we said that we were becoming an employee-owned business, they were quite impressed by that, because they thought, wow, this company cares for employees. So maybe, you know, they'll care more about our project and our staff. So I think that's helped us get more business. So, I mean, the fact that we've actually, you know, in 2 years increased our staff by so many shows that, you know, we are getting more clients and more work through them. I think the employee-owned business model has really helped with that.
Thank you. Fascinating.
I wonder if I could say a little bit about our employee ownership survey. The survey is conducted by myself and my colleague Andrew Robinson of the University of Leeds. What we're aiming to do is look at the whole population of employee-owned firms in the UK. We currently estimate that there's about 250 firms who meet our definition of employee ownership, and we've got just under half of those in the survey. Most of the witnesses here from employee-owned firms have contributed to the survey. Our current estimate is that about 240,000 people are employed in employee-owned businesses, which would be about 0.8% of employment in the UK. One of the things that comes out from the survey is that employee ownership comes about in different contexts and for different reasons. We find that about a third of cases come about through business succession, and here a strong motive is to protect the company from falling into the hands of competitors. We find about a quarter are motives similar to those of the last speaker, where a partnership is seeking to widen its ownership to a broader number of people. We have about 15% from privatisation and 23% from startups and divestment, and a very, very small percentage indeed, 1 or 2%, arising from business failure. In terms of sectors, we find about 20% in manufacturing, getting on for 50% in professional and business services, and then about somewhere between 15 and 20% in what you might call personal services, which are often ex-public services. We don't currently have anybody in transport or in hotel and catering. Now, the transport one is quite interesting, because if you were doing this inquiry in the early 90s, transport would have been the dominant group of firms that were employee-owned firms when the bus industry was privatised. So I hope that is a little bit drier than the stories that my colleagues are able to tell, but I hope that gives you a portrait of the sector as a whole.
Okay, thank you. I'm quite keen to hear from the others who haven't contributed, Joanna and Calum, just get your stories and how you arrived at the models you're at. Maybe Joanna, do you want to start?
As a consortium cooperative, Screen Facility Scotland was reborn out of, in some ways, a lot of threats to our sector, where the companies were perhaps feeling isolated, or that there were issues affecting their business that they couldn't tackle singly, and also that those companies perhaps were not engaging with policy setters, decision makers, and so on, in such a way that the correct routes to funding could be achieved and the support to the sector could be guaranteed. So that then, by pulling together under this model, it allowed for us to, in the first instance, start to address that weakness. I'm a firm believer, as is SFS, that you need to get your own house in order to move forward and make progress within your sector. The model that was offered by CDS, which we came across through the CDS Prize, seemed to be so efficient, one, to get underway, that was quite compelling, because I think had we started to get involved in legal ventures, joint ventures, things like that, I don't think we would have got off the ground. But with the model that was presented and with all the background and support that CDS gave us in order to become established, that set us off on a swift course where we very quickly started to achieve a number of the goals we wanted to achieve. We also were quite quickly able to plug in collaboratively with Creative Scotland, who of course is our main public body for the creative sectors, and Scottish Enterprise and SDI. So as a group, we have benefited from being able to present our case more formally, more rounded out, with lots of different viewpoints, but in a way that's distilled so that those who are having to make a decision, can they support us, can they give us funds, can we join in with some activity they're already doing, quicker, more effective decisions can be made. So just as a couple of examples, from the diplomacy advocacy type side, we are now involved in a lot of the sectoral scrutiny that's going on in the film business, which doesn't need to be touched upon because you have your own committee for that. We have been supported by Creative Scotland to engage with UK Screen, which allows us to have a combined voice within Westminster through that vehicle. So it just keeps our foothold quite loudly in both ends of the country. We have worked with Scottish Development International to go to international trade events like IBC, and next month we are going to go to the Games Development Conference in California. So those mechanisms were already existing, but the member companies that we had didn't know they were there, perhaps, or didn't know how to engage with them effectively, and didn't know how, even if they did, how they might be able to afford to go, so we can get into a position of shared costs or grant support to achieve these end goals for the member companies. And finally, when it comes to business, one of the really compelling arguments for the model was, I think when I first went to a presentation about the model, it described it as the DAISY situation, where you have the consortium in the middle and the member companies are all on the outside like petals. So each company remains distinct and you don't compromise its brand, you don't compromise who they are, what they do. But this model in the middle allows any combination of those petals to pull together to then try to generate more work for either just those companies that are targeting that work or for the wider membership. When you are in on location for film and television or commercial, whatever, it is an enormous collaborative effort. And turning up now on projects where member companies have already had collaborative communication with the client, and then we're all turning up delivering very disparate and different services. But doing that, and especially to the international clients, they can then see that landing in Scotland to make a project of whatever nature is joined up, is cohesive, is professional, it has the services that they want. So that's the where we would look to drive business growth for the member companies, and so an intangible project turnover results as well. There are, of course, a number of areas we still need to address, a number of sectoral weaknesses that we're working on, but it's the model that we are part of has allowed us to plug in a much more effective and professional business-like manner, in my view.
Okay, thank you.
Calum, from the point of view of Portpatrick Harbour, how did you arrive at the model that you used?
In Portpatrick, prior to being the Portpatrick Harbour Community Benefit Society, there was a charity in place before us, the Portpatrick Trust. That was a company limited by guarantee with a charitable status. They tried to purchase Portpatrick Harbour prior to us and actually got into rather severe difficulty financially. Consequently, when the whole community of the village actually found out the real underlying terms of that, they decided to move on from that and form the Community Benefit Society. We engaged the third sector. They came in and advised us and led us on to Community Share Scotland, where they've obviously advised us, and we had to actually build a new model, a community benefit society that would gain charitable status with Oscar. That didn't exist, that model, at the time. So that has been very successful. We went on and we raised £100,000 in just about 3 weeks by selling community shares. We had a very large oversubscription. A lot of interest in it. It's been very successful. The avenues of finance weren't open to us previously with the old model. It's fair to say, had we not been able to form that community benefit society, gaining the charitable status and moving on to the community share, that Portpatrick would have lost its harbour, and it would have been an absolute disaster. But now we have a good bright future. 560 member shareholders, all fully involved, all want to see it go the right way. And we're now in the process of taking a harbour which, to be fair, hasn't really seen much change from the mid-1800s. It's got one water spigot and that's it. But we're now looking to engage, we're embracing actually the Community Empowerment Act, where we have a small strip of land behind our harbour which we're looking to take over from the local council. It's a bit of wasteland to them, but to us it's very valuable in as much as that it's going to allow us to put in the facilities we want for like toilets and showers for the modern sailor. We don't want to spoil the charm of the old harbour. We want to keep the skyline, so rather than build up, we would like to build into this hill and basically keep it nice and charming as it should be. So, yeah, I think that pretty much covers us.
Okay, thank you very much. Just I mean, as a matter of interest, in terms of your community shares that you sold, who was able to buy them? Was it people living in a particular geographic area, or were they more widely sold?
Anybody on the planet Earth. And they did.
And they did, right. So it wasn't just purely people living in Portpatrick.
No, Germany, Bermuda, Canada, all over. But we probably sold over a third would be locals in the actual area. We're only a small population of just about 550. We had about another third would have went to extended family or people that, for example, people I grew up with have moved away and most likely come back. And the other third would be people who just had a genuine interest in helping a small community, whether it be they came on holiday and loved the place because it's picturesque. Sailors, big amount of sailors and yachtsmen come in, yeah.
And so you raised £100,000, more or less. So have you had raised more money subsequent to that, or has that been enough to do the things you want to do?
That's been enough. The amount of money we had to raise to actually secure the harbour into local ownership was £75,000. It was identified by cooperatives that with our business plan we could raise a further 25, which would take us up to 100, and that would be used to try and help us kickstart the regeneration, because the harbour really has not seen anything since the mid-1800s. So we are now actively planning to try and put in facilities. We're going to chase after grant funding and obviously engage more services.
Great, thank you. Kelly?
Yeah. Can I just add, although Portpatrick did have the wealth of investment from all over the world, there are many different ways by which community groups can choose to write their rules, which are similar to constitutional documents, but that's what they're called within the society sector, to either say that they will accept investment from anywhere and everywhere, or working within certain parameters for to ensure that they can access certain funding or certain legislation, they can then also have a constraint put in place saying such is the case with Calum and the Colty Bragan Camp 21 self-catering heritage accommodation, where they said 60% of investors had to come from the local area, and they dictated what that was. So it's a very robust yet nimble model, the Community Benefit Society, in order to attract investment and also either keep that sort of control in a certain area if that's what's required, or if it's a community of interest, bring that in from further afield and kind of shore that up as well. So it's a very, very useful way of operating and can be done and utilised in many ways.
Thank you. Okay, welcome Patrick Harvey to the committee. Good morning. Gordon MacDonald.
Just to go back to a point that Karen raised, I think if I picked you up correctly, you said that when you took over the business, you had no experience of managing or running the business. And I'm just wondering what kind of support you had at that time in order to go over that hump. And also, what support in terms of how did you finance the takeover of it? And just before, the other thing I was wanting to ask Calum was, the community share model, there seems to be quite a good appetite out there for it. Certainly in my constituency, the Harlow Hydro scheme was actually oversubscribed as well. But how would you have filled the funding gap if you hadn't been oversubscribed? Was there enough support out there to make that gap? So that's my 2 points.
Well, how we funded the, I suppose, the kind of buyout of the partners, we're still paying them at the moment. So we agreed a financial value for the business, and then what we've agreed is over 5 years, a portion of the profits would be paid to the partners to pay for that that buyout. So we didn't really have to raise funds initially, but obviously we're making money as we're running the business, and that's was a very kind of gentle way of the partners getting the value for the practice and us being able to afford it. During the recession, actually, we had a very bad experience with the banks. I don't know if I'm allowed to say this, but...
go on.
There was a time when we actually didn't get a salary. We had to say to the staff, we can't pay you. And the banks were just not going to give us any more money. So I think that made the partners realise we've got to find a business model that means that we don't have to rely on the banks. So luckily, the recession is now over, so the construction industry is much more buoyant, we've been able to build a buffer. So we hopefully will never have to go back to the banks again and say, can you increase our overdraft because of that really bad experience? So that was how we kind of financed the employee-owned purchase of the business. And then how we actually then learned how to manage the business. Well, because we started the process, I suppose, 4 years ago, we did actually employ a business coach. I know that sounds probably a bit kind of American and a bit corporate. And he was a private business coach. He actually... It was quite expensive, but he was invaluable in actually explaining to us how to run the business from an operational point of view. So, you know, we're just used to building buildings and, you know, designing buildings, whereas he told us how to organise the structure of the business, and we kind of devolved all the responsibilities. So in the past, it was the partners that decided everything. What we felt for the employee-owned business route is that we would all share the responsibility, that there wouldn't be, you know, just the board of directors that would make all the decisions, that we would have different groups where decisions about the business and the way forward of the business could be discussed and debated. So it was really an evolution. So, you know, that's taken 4 years. And I think because of that, we have changed a lot in 4 years, but you've not really noticed that change, and we've learned a lot about business. And I think we must have learned something, because we are quite profitable now and we're employing more members of staff, and our geographical reach as well of our architecture is widening. So, you know, that model is working for us. And we actually developed our own business model. We didn't just, you know, take a business model out of a kind of a textbook. We evolved our own business model, and we've actually got a little document which every new member of staff, we give them the document, and they kind of then read that and understand these different layers of kind of management.
Thank you. Calum, do you want to answer the question about funding?
Yeah, sure. For us and our community, I think it's fair to say that the former trust that was in place, it had got itself into financial difficulty, as I explained before, and... there was no real avenues left open for that. That's where the Community Benefit Society comes in for us. In the short term, the agreement that Trust had actually entered into had led to a default where the actual harbour would have been repossessed within a very short period of time. Obviously quite ugly scene. But Community Share Scotland brought in Social Investment Scotland, and they provided us with a temporary bridging finance of the £75,000. That was conditional, obviously, to that we were going to raise a community share. We had good feedback that there would be a fairly strong appetite for it. I think it's fair to say that to come from where it did and do as good as it did, it quite clearly proves that it's a model that not only can work for us, but definitely can work for other people. The fact that you don't have to be local to the area, and that you can be basically anywhere on planet Earth and buy, it works very well, in this much as that we used to think we had a small community, but we found we don't. We're actually quite a big community worldwide, because it's quite a diverse world now. And why someone who lives in Barbados wants a share in Portpatrick Harbour? Well, guess what? He comes on holiday and he just likes it and he wants to support it. And that's the diversity that model has offered to our group. And I think lots of other groups should be lucky enough to take it on.
Okay. Mike Kuenssberg.
Thank you. I'd like to return to the points that both Karen and Kelly have made about the variety of structures that can be set up. There is not one one structure that fits all, and indeed one can write one's own rules literally as one wants. And I'd like to just go back for a moment to the John Lewis model. It's very straightforward. There is one owner, which is the trust. There is also a model which says every individual will have a share. There is also a model which is a hybrid, whereby you have a trust and you have individuals. In the case of Scott and Fife, the employee benefit trust has 93%. The employees, all 100 of them, have 7%. And I think there's something quite, I would almost say almost romantic about the idea that employees can buy shares in the company rather than just be given them or just have a right through the trust model. So that in Scott and Fife, what we did was to say, first of all employees will be shareholders, and we started by giving them £500 each worth of shares. And then we go down the profit share model as well, and we have a profit share scheme, and we say half of that will be paid in shares. We then have a savings investment scheme, whereby people can, under the legislation, buy up to £3,600 worth of shares a year out of their weekly or monthly pay, which has the benefit that you then do not pay national insurance or PAYE on that, so that your £3,600 actually only costs you, depending on your tax rate, something like £2,500, £2,700. There is then the possibility also to award partnership shares in line with whatever scheme you care to devolve. We say according to our results, so if we have very good results, we will give to those who are buying shares additional shares. Under the legislation, you can give up to 2 shares for each share that is bought. Which means that somebody on an annual basis, if a company is doing well, could acquire up to around £10,000 worth of shares per year for at a cost or net cost of about £2,600, £2,700. If you then assume that the company is going to perform in line with the employee-owned company norms of 4% and 5% productivity a year, you would hope to see the share price increasing. And over a period of 10, 20, 30 years, which may be the period which people are working in the company, that can become a significant equity pot. And how we sold it to the employees was that we said, look, you have a national pension, which is not going to see you through life. You have a company pension, and we also were going to sort that out because we had a DB and a DC scheme, and we brought them much closer together. But as a result of this, you will also have an equity pot, which could be many tens of thousands and even over £100,000 if all works well. And it was on that basis that we sold the whole scheme. So the final point I want to make is we mustn't get carried away by employee ownership. It is not the magic bullet. You have to do all the other managerial things, whether it's innovation or what have you. But it is a phenomenally rich facilitation process, which I would commend a whole series of people to.
Thank you, Nick. Okay, Jack Brody.
Thank you. Having been down at Portpatrick just a few months ago, I still don't know how you fill that harbour with just one spigot. But never mind. Just following on the point that Nick has just made, I had a similar circumstance with the company in Fife. And while financial ownership was important, and again, people who left the company were required to sell the shares back to the company for will effectively will add to their pension. But there's more than just exactly the financial side. There's the involvement of the employees in the development of processes or products. And I just wonder, perhaps ask Sarah initially. You know, I asked the question this morning when I talked about the seminar conference with Collaborative Futures last week, and looking at a film which covers six companies in Germany, which indicated, you know, full ownership, financial and managerial and decision making. What involvement have you found? What encouragement is there on that side of the ownership? Not just, you know, we own shares and that's it.
Thank you. Well, in terms of employee ownership, our service is one of raising awareness, because the market failure is the lack of understanding of the model. So in raising awareness, we're sharing the stories, the type of stories we've heard here today in terms of how it works. In terms of the support for those who then transition into employee ownership, our role is to provide that initial advice to and undertake feasibility studies and support the implementation. Thereafter, most importantly, as you're highlighting, it's our focus needs to be on how you embed the culture of employee ownership. And we do that in a number of different ways. There's a growing number of employee-owned businesses, so learning from each other is a key aspect of that. And the Employee Ownership Association has established regional groups across the UK. We were one of the first in Scotland. And that's allowing peer support between employee-owned businesses, not just at a leadership level, but right throughout the business. That's one of the dynamics of employee ownership, is everybody's an owner. So you get some really vibrant learning and sharing your experience. There are private sector consultancies that are specialists in this area, and many employee-owned businesses draw upon their expertise. And also in terms of the public sector, Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands Enterprise, we have a wide range of services focused on leadership and organisational development. Progressive workplace practices are very much part of those, and they play two roles. From my perspective, they are raising awareness of this type of model, and also providing support for businesses to enhance their employee engagement, which is clearly important to all businesses, but is an absolute key ingredient to what makes employee ownership work.
Kavita, if I may ask Simon, clearly a large company, and maybe an individual who runs a small company, how do you achieve that employee involvement in decision making?
So from a John Lewis perspective, it starts with a very strong governance approach and then flows through. So we've got what we would describe as formal democratic governance arrangements and then informal arrangements. The formal ones take the form of three governing authorities within John Lewis. So when the founder handed the business over to us, he set up the first governing authority as the chairman. So the chairman in our business is the chief executive and chairman, so effectively has decision-making rights over anything that he or she wants in the organisation. But in order to temper that level of power, the founder put in place two other governing authorities. One of them is the Partnership Council. So this is a member body of 80 members who are elected from across the 90,000 partners in our organisation. They're elected by the people that work in the organisation to represent them for a three-year term. So it's our internal parliament. And that body meets with the chairman at least twice a year. They meet more frequently, but at least twice a year for what we call the holding to account session. And the holding to account session is just after the full year results and the half year results, where clearly our owners are very keen to understand how our business has performed under the leadership of people who, like the chairman, are leading the organisation. And they vote on his leadership. And if two-thirds of them were to vote against the chairman, he'd be removed from office immediately. And a new chairman will be found. So he holds his power lightly. The third governing authority we have is the Partnership Board. So a traditional sort of board in many sort of contexts. It's chaired by the chairman. He appoints five members that sit on the board by virtue of their executive position within the organisation. But the Partnership Council, as the other governing authority, elect five members to sit on the board. And they could be anybody that works in our organisation. So you've got power held in a very sort of balanced way. Now, you could argue that the chairman being the casting vote individual with the five and five balanced equally could take a casting vote that decided in the way that wasn't in favour of maybe the elected representatives, but then he's held to account twice a year, so he always holds his power very lightly. So that's the formal governance arrangements that sit within our business. Informally, I mean, it's very much like any other organisation. The power of the line manager and leadership in an organisation is so critical to make sure that employees feel both engaged, empowered, motivated, have a sense of purpose, sense of well-being. But what I find in the employee-owned sector is it's more consistently delivered. And so our informal networks are effectively our line managers wanting to make sure that the way in which they deliver an ownership model in John Lewis is enhanced, because they know that they are effectively an extension of the chairman. And so when the chairman stands for his account session, he knows that he's being held accountable not just for what he's done, but for what all of the line managers that effectively are an extension of him have done in the line of their duty with their partners. So there is a very sort of informal but important element to our governance structure, as well as a very formal governance part of it, which kind of influences the way in which it all operates.
Can we go on the smaller company?
Yeah, somebody else want to contribute on the same point? Yeah. Nick, do you want to come in?
Yes. If I gave the impression that it was all about finances, I'm sorry. In our structure, we have an employee-elected director with full rights to all knowledge. That's one out of a board of six. There is a monthly access to management where the chief executive talks to everybody. We have ongoing training, and that is really important, training in terms of understanding of company issues as well. And we have reduced the terms for directors from 3 years, which is the norm, to 2 years. So every 2 years, each director is actually up for re-election by an AGM at which all employees are present. Now, there's the argument which says, yes, but the trust is in control, so it's in the power of the trustees. But we've chosen, and Jackie in the public gallery knows about the long debate we had about how to balance the trustees, but effectively the trustees, if they find that 100 people out of 100 say they don't want to re-elect a director, they would be very foolish to say, well, actually, you guys don't know what you're talking about, and we think that they should continue. So there is genuine democracy from that point of view.
Andrew, you were keen to come in.
Yeah, if I could just add to what's been said already with some more statistics, forgive me. The research from the UK and the USA over many years has suggested that if your employee-owned company is going to be effective, that it's very important that the employees have a strong sense of ownership. And the two factors which influence that sense of ownership most strongly is one, a sense of involvement in decision making, and secondly, that people do get some financial outcome in terms of profit share. Second point, briefly, following up from Nick's point, looking at cases where employee ownership has come about through business succession, about 40% have an employee, one or more employee directors on the board, and about a third have what you might call an employee shareholder council, a bit like the partnership board at John Lewis. And then finally, on training, I think training is a particularly important aspect of employee ownership. There's all sorts of incentives that mean that employee-owned firms can devote more resources to training. We find in the survey that 83% of employee-owned firms say they devote more resources to training than otherwise comparable firms. And you can see why training is more likely to happen, because from the individual employee point of view, they're getting a promise from the company that if they invest their body and soul, as it were, and their development in the company, they will get some payoff from it. Equally, from the company point of view, taking into account that employee turnover tends to be lower in employee-owned companies, they can devote resources to training with a sort of greater security that employees who've been trained aren't going to then disappear off to a competitor. So there's a kind of virtuous circle that promotes and facilitates high levels of training in employee-owned firms.
Thank you. Kelly, you were keen to come in.
I was just going to say that although they are community organisations, they are enterprises when we talk about community share offers and community benefit societies. And like all of these employee-owned organisations, they are very much held to account and engagement is mission critical to that onus. And the sort of four strands will be a strong business plan, and anyone will know this as well as Calum, but also very good governance and very, very good engagement. And then an offer that is put out on the table, and those people then choose to invest and become member owners. Now, what we see through statistics with some of our consortium partners, which include DTAS, Development Trust Association Scotland, Rocket Science, but in this case, the Community Shares Unit down south, which is UK-wide, are the statistics, but we've seen them proven in our 8-year offers here, is that over 34% of those members who are member investors turn up for AGMs, which many enterprises, community or otherwise, would be very excited to see. We also see that over 32% then go on to volunteer their time or skills after the share offer is completed versus that sort of early stage excitement where all the froth is happening and then you make it happen and then it kind of trickles out the way. It's an ongoing process. So we see very similar trends, but on a smaller community level. But actually what that does is it has a carry-on effect and then that moves and expands out the way for more innovative things to happen both in communities but in then the business world that those people are part of.
Thank you. Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Just from an example from the consortium cooperative point of view, our member companies really, the structure is kept very flat. The voting system is one member, one vote. The activities that we do vary widely in the amount of effort and collaboration that's required to achieve them. So in order to try not to have large meetings trying to push through certain things that we need to do, we have the wider membership group and then we have a working group. The working group is pulled from the wider membership group. Within those groups, there are companies, so there's pools of experience and talent that can ebb and flow depending on what's on the table that needs to be sorted out, whether it's something on the promotion or advocacy level, or whether it's something on business development, or whether it's something on production tendering. There's a large pool of people to pull from. We put them into the middle. We have a working group, but none of it is exclusive, where if you're on the working group for this particular period of time, nobody else can come. At any point, any member can come to a working group meeting. What we're just trying to do is make it a smaller group to push things forward, because otherwise we wouldn't want to get into a situation where it was too unwieldy to make decisions. That working group turns over every year. We've just listening to Kelly about her attendance records. Our AGMs are held annually and we get almost 100% attendance. We typically get at least one person per company coming to the AGMs, because at that point, that's the point where people can then say, do you know, I've had a quiet time on SFS last year because I was too busy working. This year, I need to get stuck in because it's a particular issue I want to get involved with. And they come and volunteer their services maybe for that year in the working group. But it's very fluid, very flexible, because every single one of our companies is working in a sector which is unpredictable. The level of work is extremely unpredictable and variable, and also geographically dispersed. So I can't expect my members to turn up if they're working in Northern Scotland or London or abroad. So it, as a model, it's completely different to the employee-owned model that's been described, but it works very well for what we're trying to achieve.
Okay. Thank you.
It's very similar to that. with community shares and community benefit societies, where it is completely democratic and one member, one vote. No matter how much you've invested, everyone has an equal say, and then the committee is then elected from there. Very much the case.
Okay, I think Lewis McDonald was the one who's going to come in next. Yeah.
Thank you very much. I had a couple of lines of questioning related, I think, which I'd like to explore. First of all, Portpatrick, clearly I know less well than some of my colleagues in the committee, but I'd be interested to know whether at root, before the trust, which clearly was an issue, whether you had a willing seller or an unwilling seller. And I guess the wider question coming from that is how, and it's for Sarah Deas as well as for Calum Currie, is how far the development of community benefit societies can support community rights, for example, a community right to buy in circumstances where assets are being neglected or not properly used, and whether that's close to the model that you've developed in Portpatrick and whether it is a wider application that could be supported across Scotland.
Well, to touch on the seller, the Harbour was previously in private hands for many years. It was actually prior to the trust attempting to purchase it was actually a property investor based in Jersey who really didn't have much caring for our community, I can assure you that. But moving on from that, the model of the community benefit society, it offered to us options and flexibility that we certainly didn't have before. I think it's fair to say, touching on the governance that we're talking about with trustees and the responsibilities, having seen this in action for real, we had an EGM of that trust where 160 of the community turned up and politely asked 8 trustees to vacate the building upon hearing what they had basically done. You couldn't write it. We inherited a negative situation where they had committed to pay £350,000 for something which they hadn't even had valued and subsequently stands valued at £75,000 today. So that shows you the negativity that we had to overcome. The community didn't have the full consultation prior to that and they didn't know until that EGM. And I think their actions speak clearly for themselves. But we took the positive rein and we had to explore any option that was available. And I think it's fair to say after quite an exhaustive search, there was one that stood out as pretty much standalone, and that was the Community Benefit Society. And the support we got from the whole of the third sector, but especially Community Share Scotland and cooperatives, was absolutely second to none. And I would seriously have to commend them, because without their help, well, who knows what would be happening in my village.
And what's exciting about the community right to buy and land reform and asset transfer pipeline that's happening now with the new Community Empowerment Act and the Land Reform Bill is that Scottish Government has had the foresight to include community benefit societies as legitimate governance bodies through which these legislative avenues can be now taken. Previously, it was only, as you'll know yourselves, companies limited by guarantee. And so now groups like Portpatrick can enact the legislation to their benefit. And that will make quite an exciting and engaging offering for groups across Scotland. And I think we'll see a lot coming through the pipeline once the guidance comes through. We're already seeing a lot through the pipeline, but it leverages in when you can show that you've got a community, be it of place or interest, particularly place in this circumstance with 500 members strong and however many from the local community, it really does help to leverage movement with those who might not be so keen to sell. And sometimes you don't have to enact the legislation because they can see that there is a real community desire and need, and it will be kept in trusteeship for the wider long term. But then you still have the legislation that has been, you know, brought up to date and is very useful and now can include community benefit societies.
And the other area, and that's very interesting and very useful, and I can think at least of one set of constituents with whom I will discuss your experience, because it's very relevant indeed. But in the other area I was interested to explore was around situations of business failure, and I take the point that Andrew made that business failures are small proportion of the total employee-owned business, and I also completely accept the point that employee ownership should not be for unsuccessful companies, it should be for companies which can grow and prosper. However, again, looking at recent experience in Scotland, the steel industry in deep trouble, and I know in France, when something similar happened, the law there gave the employees a first right of refusal. And in that case, they've set up a successful steel business arising from that. So I'd be interested in the context of the legislative position here, and particularly Cooperative Development Scotland and the enterprise agencies, whether and in what ways Cooperative Development Scotland is drawn in by government and by the enterprise agencies when facing a failing business and people's jobs at risk, and whether an employee right to buy, like a community right to buy, might strengthen the position of people in those circumstances.
I mean, the employee right to buy puts the employee ownership model on the radar, and that's an attraction. But there has to be a viable business. I mean, it goes right back to the commerciality of the business. What employee ownership offers is clearly that motivation, that engagement that actually may, in difficult circumstances, enable a business to reinvent itself and to become commercially viable again. But there has to be a market, there has to be trading circumstances that allow the business in whatever model to survive.
But at the moment, so for example, with Tata Steel or with Young Seafood in Fraserburgh, when the government sets up a task force,
yes,
what's your role? Are you formally consulted, or are you actively engaged to discuss options with ministers and with the enterprise agencies?
Yes, well, being part of Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands Enterprise, that brings the model to the table. So whilst we may not myself have a place at that table, my colleagues would draw me in if there was an opportunity that we could help take forward. The PACE team is also another arm, clearly, that would draw us in as appropriate.
Is it, would it be fair to ask you, is it your experience in recent months where a number of these task forces have been set up in the event of businesses being in trouble, have you been drawn in, and has your input had any consequences, had any positive outputs in any of these recent cases?
Yes, we've certainly been on the radar, and I've spoken to colleagues. They've known that we're ready to respond if they felt that the model could be a solution. In some of the cases you're relating to there, it hasn't progressed to that, but certainly there's the willingness and the expertise available to be drawn in if it was felt appropriate.
That's very helpful. I wonder if other witnesses have...
Joan had a follow-up, and then Simon wanted to come in, so we'll start with Joan.
Yes, thanks very much. Notwithstanding the situation that Lewis has outlined, when there is a crisis, if we're talking about, when there's not a crisis, when, businesses are viable, part of Scotland I represent, because businesses tend to be smaller, they would tend to go through Business Gateway as their first port of call. To what extent do you liaise with Business Gateway, and how confident are you that Business Gateway is pointing potential employee-owned businesses to the different models that are available and that you're promoting? Is it being promoted enough through Business Gateway?
Our model is to be a small core team that works through other people, so to get that multiplier effect. So we've obviously related to Scottish Enterprise and Highlands and Islands Enterprise, but Business Gateway is absolutely part of the engine to draw our services to the attention of businesses. So we provide training, awareness raising and training to frontline advisors. In two of the local authorities, Glasgow and Edinburgh, you have cooperative councils, so they're absolutely committed to the cooperative enterprise model. And so we're working very intensely with those business gateway teams to ensure that they have an understanding of the models and can draw upon us when required.
And what about other parts of the country? Because in a sense, other parts of the country, like rural areas, have seen the, you know, like the success of Portpatrick. They, you know, like there's even more of a place, you know, they could have a transformative effect on a community. And have you done any kind of surveys that, that kind of like give you an indication as to, you know, how on board Business Gateway is in communities around the country?
There's 32 local authorities and the associated business gateways. We aim as far as we can to ensure everybody understands our services. It's a challenge. We're here and we try and get as much traction as we can to ensure that the frontline advisors within the gateways and also in the other professions, you know, professional advisors, lawyers, accountants and bankers are very much aware of our services because quite often they're the trusted advisor that a business might draw upon.
Tim.
I'd just like to support and build on what Sarah has said, really. I think that the conversations we're having are around a movement. It's sort of a movement which is well known in some areas, it's less well known in other areas. And sometimes some of the totemic stories that you hear about successes are really helpful in just bringing to life exactly what we mean by it, because the model of employee ownership is an unusual one. It's still, you know, in terms of the research we've done, about 5% of the UK's GDP. So it's relatively small, but it's growing, and it's growing at about 10% a year. And one of the things I think that's very important is some political commitment, making sure that we've got awareness amongst professional advisors. So when options are being put on the table for businesses, when they are considering a crossroads potentially in their future, that they've got options that they can consider which cover all sorts of models, including employee ownership. So whether it's tax advisors, legal advisors, accountants, we have to make sure that their knowledge is as good as it can be and that their confidence in talking about the model is as good as it can be, because very often they don't mention it because they're not confident. And if they're not confident, they won't go there. And there are undoubtedly some missed opportunities when that happens. So moments like this, you know, and I applaud the Scottish Government for doing this sort of event, are really important in the sort of movement and trying to make sure that people really get behind it and understand it. It's not the only way of doing business, but it is a really important way of adding to a sort of a plural economy and making sure that there is diversity and a real rich tapestry in the way in which we orchestrate everything that we do. I would just want would like to build on the notion that employee-owned businesses are always successful, because they're not always successful, and sometimes they do come up against challenges and difficulties. I think one of the things that we've experienced in the members of the Employee Ownership Association, for example, is members, when they face difficulties, have the opportunity, they have the benefit of being able to take decisions for the longer term. They're not being driven by the short-term needs, maybe, of shareholders breathing down their neck. They are in it for the long term. And sometimes those longer term decisions, which can sometimes be counterintuitive, are the right decisions to keep a business in operation. And we've heard, for example, about you know, one organisation that had difficulties that didn't pay their people. I mean, John Lewis has had a similar sort of example where bonus wasn't paid and people actually gave a week's worth of salary back just after the Second World War when things were difficult. So you have the ability to make counterintuitive decisions and to involve people in it. But I come back to my first point, which is this is about a movement, and it's about as many people as possible understanding it, so people have the choice to be able to go into it if they feel it's right for them. It won't be right for everybody, but it's such a shame that people don't know the choice is there when they do come up against a crossroads, because sometimes this choice is the right one for them and it might just be the lifeline that they need.
Yeah, thanks. I should just say, for the record, this is not a Scottish Government event. It's a Scottish
Parliament.
I beg your pardon. The two are easily confused.
Pardon.
Thank you. I just wanted, just before we leave this point, because I think it's quite an interesting point that Lewis McDonald raised about, you know, business failure being a catalyst for change and how realistic that is. I wonder, Nick Kuenssberg, if you have a view on that. Is it realistic to expect in the event of a business going to administration that employee ownership is then a route out of that?
Well, I would endorse what Sarah Deas has said. There has to be a commercial case
And usually the problem is lack of cash and employee ownership, unless you have an extended community, as in Portpatrick, where you can produce a pile of cash, but it has to be matched by a business plan which people believe in and are going to undertake. Otherwise, one is trading with a false prospectus. And I actually think that in most cases, unless there's been some really crassly bad management, that if a company is going bust, there are probably quite good reasons why that company is going bust. And as I said earlier, employee ownership is not a magic bullet. There has to be a lot more to be developed. That I would just add, in the case of Scott and Fife, which is in a very difficult industry, we are not surviving just because of employee ownership. We are surviving because of a huge effort made to change the business model and to introduce or to embed innovation at the core of the company. And those who visited the company will have seen what is done there. So both of them have been necessary.
I'm very conscious that one of the many Scottish Government task forces I sit on is the Fyfe task force, dealt to deal with the Tullis Russell failure. And Tullis Russell was, of course, an exemplar of employee ownership. So it's not always a panacea.
An impossible
trading situation
to be in. Yeah.
Sorry, Joanne, I think you were next to come in. Yeah.
Okay, thanks very much. Excuse me. I think there is a case where it's not business failure, but market failure. And for example, I mean, late Helen Heady was an MSP. As a young woman, set up a nursery cooperative in London. Now, that wasn't because there wasn't need. It was because nobody had ever thought that actually should provide that kind of service in that kind of way. And I'm interested in how there is some rigour around the opportunities around cooperatives, particularly community cooperatives, because I think community cooperatives create economic opportunity as well as social opportunity and regenerate areas. And that's actually why initially Cooperative Development Scotland, when it was established, was put inside Scottish Enterprise, because it was seen as much as an economic issue. It wasn't just about hugging communities, it was regenerating them. And I was interested to know whether Sarah thinks there's now a time to review the role of Cooperative Development Scotland to ensure that there's that rigour, and that we perhaps do take in housing. For example, housing was deliberately excluded because Community Scotland existed as an advocate, and now there is not that kind of agency arguing for social housing and a cooperative model, and I think the cooperative model in housing is rather fallen by the wayside, and there have been fantastic examples of them. I wonder if you have a view on that, and to what extent there is a government level across portfolios a responsibility for advocating, particularly cooperatives. And again, I know that people who want to establish, for example, renewable cooperatives, so wind power, have not somehow been able to, have found it difficult to access grants and so on. And I wonder if you thought that was a further issue.
Thank you. Yes, I'll pick each of those in turn. Our focus sitting in SEN High, and we must remember that High has a community remit as well, is very much focused on enterprise in all its forms, including within community enterprise. Recognising the potential of the community shares model, and recognising that we're, as any business says, resource constrained, but the potential was so significant that myself and the Development Trust Association Scotland came together, and we seeded the idea of Community Share Scotland. And this is a couple of years ago. Now, Community Share Scotland is funded by the Big Lottery and by the Carnegie Foundation, and it's a three-year initiative. It's halfway through that three-year period. So I guess the question that we will now be facing, I sit on the steering group for that initiative, is what happens next? There is a growing demand and need for support in relation to community cooperatives and community share offers. And that is an issue that we'll face into at the steering group and with our partner organisations. In terms of housing, that isn't our core expertise, and you're right, Joanne, in relation to it hasn't been a focus for us in recent years. It would need to be considered in relation to what would be the best organisation in Scotland to front that, and where does the specialist expertise bed into it. Those don't need to be one and the same, but it's about how you access the right skills for the need at the time. In terms of renewable energy, we work closely with Local Energy Scotland and the CARES scheme. So we provide joined up support for any renewable energy project, similarly with Community Broadband Scotland in relation to broadband. So these initiatives, which are clearly policy priorities for Scottish Government, we're embedded through our partner organisations in providing the specialist expertise.
I just wonder how we can be more proactive. For example, in housing, it's not just about housing cooperatives taking over from local council housing. You can have housing cooperatives that meet the challenges for young people who are currently renting and before they're ready to go on to own. And I don't know where that initiative would now come from, and I wondered whether that was something that could be looked at. And also that sometimes cooperatives are defined out because they don't fit properly and therefore they don't necessarily get access. And I think that some of that's around the expertise of civil servants. And I wonder whether that would be the kind of thing that you could look at in a review. And the last point, I wondered if you've looked at the Welsh Government have had a cooperative commission, and I wondered if you've looked at that and whether there are any lessons from there for us, particularly around the points that were made earlier around supporting land reform initiatives around cooperatives in land reform and taking forward the community empowerment so that it becomes actually very real in local communities.
Yes, picking up on the last point. First, we were very engaged with the Welsh Cooperative Centre and worked closely with them, sharing learning and expertise. We input to the Commission at the time it was taking evidence, and we continue to have an ongoing relationship with them. So I do think there is benefits from the Welsh and Scottish perspective and learning together. In terms of housing, I mean, that really does come back to what is the CDS remit. Housing was explicitly excluded at the time of setting up Cooperative Development Scotland. So that is an issue, I think, that needs to be considered outside this forum.
Kuenssberg.
Can I come back very quickly on the community renewable schemes, which Joanne was talking about? Those fit actually into the definition of social enterprise, and Social Investment Scotland does a lot of work in the renewable sector in partnership with other players. So if there is a concern about where to go for funding, look to Social Investment Scotland. I'd just like to come back on the issue of company failure. Obviously, company failure, where it happens, usually happens pretty quickly. And the one thing that we do need when setting up an employee ownership project is time. It takes a lot of time, a lot of thought, and that in itself is a big distraction for management, which may be having to cope with that market failure at the same time. So the combination of the two is actually pretty dire.
I wouldn't be arguing. I mean, it annoys me if people perceive cooperatives as a place of last resort when nothing else works, because they're actively, you know, they actively can be incredibly important, particularly in rural or urban areas where there's been a lack of regeneration in creating opportunities for people. So I understand that, but I think there's some slightly different where a community cooperative is identifying need and a model to deliver it, which the market wouldn't serve.
Kelly McIntyre wanted to come in.
I just, back to market failure was one of the points that came up, and yes, if you're talking about employee ownership, both time is incredibly important, but also the robust business model behind it. And if it's failing because there isn't a commercially viable role for that to exist, then you might look at that on a community level, because you don't need the same profit margins for something to give us a very important and vital service to a community-led regeneration to have a community enterprise be successful. And I think that's something to think about if, say, community ownership isn't the right option, or perhaps a combined way of thinking about it, because actually a lot of times we see these things where vital services or vital vehicles for employment for communities are being, are failing, quote unquote, but that's being done, it's doing so because we're looking at that as a commercially viable, where some level needs to make quite a large amount of profit. On a community scale, that profit margin doesn't have to be anywhere near that size, and yet has an amazing impact on the area as well as the industry. And I just wanted to make that point. And then in terms of housing and how we think about all these other sorts of ways that we can engage the cooperative model towards filling in services are desperately important. I know that we look at that through community cooperatives and community enterprises, but also you've got the community ownership support service that are helping to kind of make these transitions for groups as well, that could potentially look into how groups could not just, could A, do the transfer from a local authority, but could also help a group spontaneously do it on their own. It might be something worth considering. And that's funded by Scottish Government.
Okay, I've got Simon and then Nathalie. Simon.
I mean, the conversation about housing is quite topical because some of you may have seen the news this morning that there is this older women's group called Ouch, which has just set up its own social housing on the basis that 60% of 75-year-old women plus tend to be on their own, either through the fact they've lived longer than their spouses or they're in divorce. And so this group didn't want to rely on the care home system. They wanted their own social housing. So they are setting something up very similar to that. And I see that the co-housing network, of which they're part, has got three representatives in Scotland. So Vivarium in Fife, Pennington Co-housing in Glasgow, and Coldies Eco Village in Perthshire. So there are some examples of that which are already live in Scotland.
Thank you. Nathalie.
A bit of an overview of some of the benefits that we've achieved from being a privately owned cooperative, which could be applied to the housing sector, it could be applied to any sector really, but maybe to prevent the stage of market failure by encouraging people to work together more. And Joan was talking earlier about SMEs and maybe rural areas. There's probably huge opportunities there to go much further in supporting particularly SMEs to work together for kind of common good, but from a for-profit point of view. Some of the more measurable benefits we've experienced have obviously been, you know, the economy of scale. So the WE agency, we have three businesses under one roof, sharing overheads, sharing office space, sharing some of our back office functions, and working together on marketing, so going out to win new business. So in turn, that's brought in hundreds of thousands of pounds of additional revenue into our businesses, and that's helped us to create jobs in Scotland. We've had a great benefit from being a bigger team than our three smaller independent companies. We've strengthened our board, so we have a board of five very experienced people from the different backgrounds and sectors. And from a client point of view as well, agencies, previously the client might have had to bring in 10 different agencies to deliver a job that we can do under one roof. So we're delivering efficiency there as well. And we've got a lot of flexibility to look at the market, particularly around technology, and make sure that we're always adapting. Then some less measurable benefits. So Karen was talking about winning business due to being employee owned. And we found the same thing being a cooperative, is that we've tendered for business and people have chosen us. And some of their feedback has been that they really like our ethos and the fact that we're bringing a number of strengths into one place and strong in three areas rather than, you know, being good at one thing and tagging the other elements on. I think we find creativity and innovation have increased just by having diversity of different people sitting in the boardroom. And equally, that can be a challenge as well. You've got three businesses with kind of quite headstrong people who run those businesses having to come together and cooperate and collaborate. But we've worked that out and that all goes very well. And I guess one challenge maybe to just share with the group that we found and we're always working on is, as a cooperative, we've got two different priorities. You've got your own business and you've got the cooperative. So we find it quite difficult sometimes juggling what the priority is, but we find all of the time and other things that we invest into driving forward the WE agency really brings huge dividends and probably at a greater scale than if we were spending that time on our own business.
Yeah, great. Okay, thank you. Okay, Gordon.
I was wanting to ask Andrew if there was any information about
what the average size of an employee-owned business is, or the ideal size. I mean, putting John Lewis to one side, but it's 90,000 employees. Is there another employee-owned business that's of the size of John Lewis in the UK? And secondly, well, why is that if there isn't another business the same size as John Lewis? And secondly, is the employee-owned business size, should that model be more aimed at companies like Park Architects with 52 employees or Scott and Fyfe with 100 employees? I mean, you know, how does it currently sit in the current economic climate?
Employee-owned firms are found in all size categories. The largest is John Lewis, as you rightly say. There is a small number of other large companies, nothing like the scale of John Lewis, but nevertheless substantial. Arup, for instance, 100% owned by a trust. It is nevertheless true that the bulk of firms do tend to be concentrated in the SME category, up to about 250 employees. I think by and large it's probably easier to organise a transition for firms that are smaller rather than giant. Just to give you some figures from the survey, the average size of firms that created during employee-owned firms created during business succession is about 80. Those created during privatisation, 640. But there's, you know, I would caution, there's a lot of diversity within those figures.
Is there any reason why we don't have another business of the size of John Lewis using this model?
That's a big question. One can see the difficulties, the profound difficulties in organising a transition of let's say another large retail firm, be it Sainsbury's or Tesco's or whatever, the amount of capital that would have to be raised to buy out significant institutional investors would be quite a challenge.
Okay.
But I think as a final point, I think a key issue here is the view of the owner or owners. So in the case of John Lewis, Spendon Lewis had a clear idea about what he wanted to do and found the means to do it. The problem with most large firms, certainly listed firms, of course, is that there's a large number of owners and they have, you know, potentially a variety of objectives, and trying to coordinate them to get together and to go for employee ownership, you can see, is profoundly challenging.
Just very briefly, clearly the one organisation that I don't think you mentioned at all this morning is the cooperative group, Scottish Cooperative Society, and the other cooperative societies. I wonder if any of those with an overview would want to comment on where they fit into the bigger picture we've been talking about today. Whether I...
It was. I don't want to jump over Lewis's question. I was responding to what Andrew was saying about.
Well, just come in with your point. Maybe give others a chance to think about the co-op.
I think I'm right in saying a long time ago in Scotland we did have another retailer who had a scheme, an employee share ownership scheme, in, and that was House of Fraser, which set up quite an innovative scheme, I believe, in the 80s. Now, I can't remember all the exact details, but I do believe that scheme came to an end through an internal decision which did involve buying back all the shares and regaining all the control within a board, I believe. So there might be something within that model of old which then changed back to private ownership and no employee share stakes at all, that could inform where we could change or adapt or move forward with the model in today's world.
Okay. Just to jump in there very briefly, if I may. Most of the major retailers have employee share ownership schemes. be it Tesco's, Sainsbury's, Marks and Spencer's. But of course, these only account for a very, very small proportion of the total equity. There are some other retail and wholesalers that do have very substantial employee ownership, but they are nevertheless considerably smaller than John Lewis.
Sorry, just let...
And ScotMid, because although they're retail, their model is a membership model, so they have democratic accountability. People can become a member of the co-op and then become involved in that way. And I'm not sure what schemes they then have around employees, but it's obviously a recognised cooperative, but a slightly different kind.
Just in response to that, there are probably two answers to the question about scale. The first is something to do with time. So I think the fact that John Lewis has been going for 150 years is going to be part and parcel of the fact that our scale has grown over time. I wouldn't see the lack of massive scale like 90,000 being a sort of a limiter at all. It's probably just time. And the other is just quickly looking at the employee ownership membership site, just trying to draw my memory banks on who's out there. CH2M, who are an engineering firm, they've got 25,000 employees. They're responsible for the contract at the moment, which is doing Crossrail in London and other big schemes of that sort. So there are some other big players out there, and I've just touched on one. So I wouldn't want anyone to think that there isn't scale already in operation, but time will obviously be a key factor.
Okay, I'm conscious we're getting towards the end of our time. There's one issue I just want to finish with, if we can, just get some views. And that's in relation to public policy and what more can be done. It's been, I think, a very good discussion. We've had a lot of talk around the advantages of the cooperative model and of employee ownership. I was very taken in Andrew's submission. You talked a bit about some of the policy changes at a UK level that came in the last few years under the coalition government that pushed this agenda forward and made it easier to go down this route. We also heard a lot about Cooperative Development Scotland and the work that's being done through Scottish Government agencies to try and promote this. I suppose my question is, what more can or should we be doing at this stage in terms of public policy to try and promote these ideas? Andrew, do you have a view?
I do have a view. You refer to the 2014 legislation, which provides very significant tax benefits for selling 50% or more of a company to an employee ownership trust. I think the people think the power of this is that because it's such a great benefit, that any professional advisor called in to advise on a business succession would be negligent if they didn't mention this as a possibility to their client. In terms of where we go next, and I'm sort of speaking from an English perspective here, I think the policy framework now is very supportive. What we need to develop further is the infrastructure to provide the support to enable conversions to take place. I think that Scotland is instructive here in terms of numbers of employee-owned firms. Scotland punches a little bit above its weight, as it were, within the UK. And my suspicion is that that's probably something to do with the fact that there is an infrastructure within Scottish enterprise that is there to provide that kind of infrastructure of advice, information, networking and so on. We have that in England in a more informal way through bodies such as the Employee Ownership Association. And in parts of the employee-owned sector, such as the mutual sector, where there's been a lot of infrastructural support. But in general terms, I think the way forward is more infrastructural support within government to provide advice, provide networks, provide information.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else got a view on this? Callum, yeah.
I've just got one thing on policy. That would be, as I mentioned earlier on, we're looking at using the community empowerment to actually take over a piece of council land at the back of a harbour, which will allow us to obviously provide services. when we approached the council, that's the Dumfries and Galloway Regional Council, and we explained what we wanted to do, they actually weren't quite aware of whether there was a policy in place for that act, and consequently came back and said it was going to be some amount of time before they'd be able to engage the process. And for us, that put a big stopper on any progress on what we're going to do planning-wise for our project. But in further consultation with them, they have actually, to give them their dues, they've came back and they've said, okay, we will pass this land over to you. You basically pay our legal fees and you can have it. It's less and best consideration situation. But it was just to highlight that the act was there, but the policy wasn't, and the guys were going, we don't really know what way to handle this. And from our side of the fence, it was a bit bewildering. But to touch on one other thing that I didn't touch on earlier, our harbour isn't just about the harbour, it's about the whole village. It actually links in for the social benefit of the village, the charitable objectives will actually, in the future, we predict within about 5 years, we'll start actually having enough surplus to actually start supporting our own infrastructure and supporting other other social needs in the village. But it also is supporting the local economy, in as much as that all the local businesses are behind us. The businesses obviously support the employment in the area, and it all comes together. For us, our village is built around the harbour. The harbour is also one of the gateways to bring people in, and that's where, for us, the social benefits pretty overarching from this model.
Thank you. Kelly.
I would say that this is exactly the exemplar that I would like to bring up, is that the Community Empowerment Act, right now we're working with over 55 groups to support them through the process of designing and exploring and issuing community share offers and creating community benefit societies to create real tangible community-led regeneration and innovation and enterprise within Scotland. And that's at the very lower end of the scale, and on the very higher end you've got the employee ownership models and the consortium models. But with our situation is, by the time the guidance comes out and we have even more people coming through the pipeline, our program will be coming to a close. And I think this is similar to many of the infrastructural support bodies will be facing a similar sort of depth of need, and we need to get things in place so that we know that we have the support available to those groups at the time when it's most needed. It's needed now, but it's going to be even more so needed in a year's time when that guidance comes out. And I think it'll be the same situation for Co-operative Development Scotland and other groups as people start to explore how they can best use this new legislation that's available to them.
Market failure is an awareness of cooperative models in all their forms. You may wish to consider how they're introduced within the education system. There is a small organisation called Cooperative Education Trust Scotland that has been working alongside schools in helping increase the awareness and understanding of cooperative models. As people then transition into further or higher education and business schools, you may wish to consider how the variety of models are presented to students.
Okay. Nathalie? No. You were looking in my direction, that was all. Anybody else a view on any other policy changes? Simon?
Yeah. I just support what Andrew has said, really, just in terms of trying to see whether we could get a level playing field for employee-owned businesses by ensuring that tax reliefs are in place for business owners that are wanting to transition with more than 51%. There are reliefs in place for employees that work in employee-owned businesses as well. And then awareness raising, which is what I've mentioned previously. And on that point, I wonder if I might just, for MSPs, hand around two documents, which will just be a takeaway to give you a sense of what plan on a page might you want to take away to understand what the sector, part of the sector, is all about.
Fine. We can get those from you at the end. Okay. Okay, well, I think if there are no other points, I think it's a good point to bring the meeting to a close. Can I, on behalf of the committee members, thank all our witnesses for coming along this morning. It's been an extremely interesting and useful session, and we will now need to go away and consider where we take this next. So thank you all, and at this point we will suspend and go into private session. Thank you.